Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show. Now, feel free to get in touch with us on this show. And remember, this show airs every Thursdays at 10 p.m. and the repeat is on Saturdays at 8 a.m. So make a date with us and learn something about how you can improve your business. Yep. Let's talk digital marketing and influencing. And this is probably one conversation that for most young people that can access phones has been on. Every day you hear someone saying, I am an influencer. The question is, what are you influencing? Did you know that there are actually basics that you need to get right for you to thrive in this business? And did you actually know that it's actually a business, or it is something you're probably just doing to earn like a 20K on a daily from some function? This week on How to Make Money, we tell you how you can actually make money, digital marketing and influencing.
My name is Albert Katuruguma, the founder and CEO of a digital media and communications company called Ivers Digital. And I'm a digital marketer. I part as a content creator. And a digital influencer on a good day. I've done this for close to 7 years, 7-8 years. I've done this from way back, university. I'm from MUBS, Nakawa. I began this halfway my first course. I did 2 courses from there. So I picked interest as a digital marketer way earlier than that though. But I took it on seriously during my university time. That's when it actually started giving me money. So something that I used to do as fun or passion actually started getting me a few bucks at campus. You know, as a campus star, you don't have a lot of income coming in. So if a chance comes that you can earn some money off just holding your smartphone and throwing out things, it got fun while I earned a little money for a Rolex during university. So then I joined a digital marketing agency. While there, I got a thought of starting my own agency. I've had this agency for a year and a half now. And yeah, we've tried to do some good work in Uganda and across the continent. We've recently done work in Cameroon. We've done work in Ethiopia. We've done work remotely in Egypt. So we do work across Africa, in Uganda, and we look forward to doing work outside Africa this year or the other year. The sky's the limit. In Uganda and our nearby neighbors, we have seen a growing need of digital marketing. Businesses have actually started to realize that, yo, this is the thing. Digital marketing got that slight push of the pandemic, the fact that everyone was at home. So businesses are moving from the old way of doing stuff and having everything go digital, or most of the things go digital. The kind of selling walk-ins, is getting cliche, but businesses have thought that, yeah, we can still do our traditional marketing mainstream, but still have that digital push where we can reach out to people on their smartphones or on the internet or social media. And that's where we come in as an agency. There's a wider reach with audience, okay? There's a wider reach with audience. And this audience is, you reach an audience that is more preferably going to buy what you're selling. Why? This is something you cannot measure well with mainstream media. For example, if I have a billboard out there or send out an ad on a TV like where you guys have come from, I wouldn't measure exactly who was seen, or whoever who was seen, are they the ones I'm targeting? But with digital marketing, I can actually get to measure and set that. Yes, still with mainstream media, you can set the demographics and whatever you're putting the billboard, but still it's largely a shot in the dark. So I believe digital marketing should be the thing, and every business should have that. There are so many players in the industry. There are so many agencies in the industry that provide digital marketing services. So yeah, of course, they can reach out to us, Ivas Digital. We're on all media platforms. We're online. We can be reached online everywhere. I believe you guys will share the how people can contact us as you run this interview. So yeah, there's so many people. And us in the business, we also do recommend our partners. In case you've given one work and they think they can't execute some of the parts of the work, we collaborate. It's a very, very big industry. It's a vast industry. It's a growing industry that actually so many people are coming in. So many young people are coming in. Brilliant young people, brilliant ideas. How do you become an influencer? One, you need a smartphone. you need to be tech savvy, yeah? Need to be familiar with technology, okay? It's a gradual thing. It's a gradual process. You have to learn a few things, okay? I've seen people come up, get numbers. Some have bought followers, what we call bots. You having numbers doesn't make you an influencer, okay? So if you can establish, we'll keep talking about niche, that I'm an influencer. You can't influence for everything. So pick a space, be so good at that, grow your following organically in that space, become an opinion leader or someone in that space that an audience listens to. Then you grow your influence one by one, one at a time. Some of us have been on some of these platforms for more than 10 years, okay? So we've come to grow an audience gradually. That if someone has 10,000 followers, they actually have good influence than someone with 200,000 followers that joined maybe Twitter or Instagram during COVID, where people were idle, people were dissing each other. There were a lot of these TVs competing for those Saturday night shows. There was a lot of noise. So it's not about the following. It's about how organic your audience is and how good your content is, okay? You having a million followers, when you can't give them as much good content as someone with 10,000, me as someone who interacts with a client, I'd rather choose someone with 10,000 followers and leave out the 1 million followers, guys, okay? Then when still you make it out there, there's clout that comes with numbers, okay? If that clout gets to your head and start misbehaving, you can mess up somewhere. We've seen so many influencers that have gone astray, okay? So stay disciplined, okay? Grow your base organically, establish a niche, be good at that. Trust me, we'll call them gigs. One gig gets you to the other. How good you execute one gets you to the other. Like I've told you, I've done this for close to 7 years. So I've come to learn what gets someone work, how they relate with a previous client, how they executed their work. That gets you to the next big work. Lessons. One, I've mentioned discipline again, okay? Discipline, how you work, how you interact with clients, okay? Then learning. Digital is so agile. So the agility that comes with digital and social media marketing, you have to stay up to your game. Digital changes quickly. I could be doing this interview now, but may run probably tomorrow, but I may tell you something now, and tomorrow it has changed. That's how quickly digital changes. So you have to stay up to your game, you must look out for the trends. Okay? Digital is trends and how agile it gets. So you have to keep up with trends, research, okay? Because digital marketing is the center of every other sector around. Why? Let it be education, medicine, banking, government, they all come back to digital marketers to do our thing. So you must have an idea on all these things. Because as an audience, they don't care. Maybe, for example, if today I'm doing work for a bank, okay, I have to have my head in the banking world to execute the work well, because the audience there is seeing the product of the banks through an influencer, and this is the same influencer that's going to do work again tomorrow for maybe Jumia, or maybe maybe a bar, okay, or maybe anything else. So you have to have your game into so many things. You have to have an idea about everything, okay? So that speaks to research, okay? Trends, like I've said, then I mentioned display, then how you interact with your audience off the internet, off social media. So what your audience sees online should be the same they have outside social media. So if you influence, so many people look up to you online. So when they find you outside internet, and you maybe fighting, maybe being abusive, maybe in nudity. So yeah. So so many things are in play. Okay, how you interact online, how you live outside online. Okay, so yeah. Then the other thing is discipline online again. I've had so many instances where an influencer has lost work, good work, with a client. Why? Like I told you, numbers can get to your head, the clout. You've seen drama on social media. You're an influencer, but you're getting into drama. You're trying to drag random people you don't know. You don't know that person you're dragging is your next client. I've heard that it was an insurance company that had, because you have to submit the names of the influencers so that they approve. So the gentleman was like, I can't use this person. I'm like, why? Like, no, this person dragged me at some point for my opinion. Why? Because these bosses, the big people, are the people with small followings in there. You can't tell. You can't tell this guy is my boss the other side, okay? So you could be dragging your boss. Okay, the boss who's giving what they call your gig plug business to give you business, you're dragging them. So you have to be disciplined online again. Yeah, basically. Then also there, to keep yourself in research, there are a lot of short courses online to do digital marketing. Google provides some, Facebook does, okay? Many of them are free. Some of them are slight cost, like maybe $50, $100. These are small courses you can do in a day if you put your heart to it, or a week. So, and you keep equipping yourself with trends, okay?
So very straight up for you there, it's important to know that every business you want to venture into has the do's and don'ts. So if you want to venture into digital marketing, just pay attention to detail. There are some things you must get right first for you to thrive, okay? Let's talk personal finance tips for this week. And in our second part of the four-part series for personal finance this week, we look at how to grow your cash flow in your business. Here are the basics.
My name is Enoth Mbeine. I'm a CEO of Med Business Consult, a small business consulting firm. I'm also a business mentor, coach, and lecturer of entrepreneurship. Last week, we were able to cover a session on how to increase your incomes for a small business. Now tonight, we would like to discuss another very interesting topic, and this is about how to increase your cash flow, or how to make your cash flow healthy for a small business. What is cash flow, first and foremost? Cash flow is basically the money that goes in your company and goes out. If I may use the financial terms, the money that comes in your business is what we call the inflows. And these inflows are as a result of sales of your goods and services, and also investments. And the outflows are the expenses, what goes out of the company. And this is usually on the expenses that you make as a company. It's extremely important as a small business owner to have a healthy cash flow, which we call a positive cash flow. Here I mean having more inflows into your company and having less inflows, less outflows. When you have a healthy cash flow, you're able to make very important decisions as a business owner. You're able to negotiate with your clients, you're able to negotiate with your suppliers, because you have the money. You're also able to take up opportunities that are available when you have cash, when you have excess cash for your business. I have a friend of mine, he has amassed enough wealth by running a business that gives him cash flow. He has been able to buy property, he has been able to buy, to make a lot of investments because of cash flow. As you always hear, cash flow is king. So, how do we increase our cash flow and make it positive? First and foremost, encourage your clients to pay quickly by reminding them all the time. Look out for your creditors. Call them all the time and make sure that they're able to pay quickly. Then also manage your stocks and supplies. When you're planning, for example, you're into manufacturing, make a schedule, a very proper schedule, to buy your materials in time. Because remember, prices change. Prices keep changing. So if you're able to buy your supplies and your materials in time and use the supplies, so you're able to utilize these services and products when the prices have increased. Then another way of increasing your cash flow is, instead of building your premises, you can have an option of renting, leasing. There you're not able to tie a lot of money and use all this money for, which you'd have used for building, to be able to help you in the business operations. One other way of increasing your cash flow is making sure that when there's an opportunity, we have offered a service for your clients or your customers, invoice them quickly. So the more you invoice them quickly, the more they will also quickly pay. And once they pay, you will be having a positive cash flow. And I earlier said, a cash flow helps you. So when you have cash in your hands as a business, you're able to negotiate with your suppliers. Build a relationship with your suppliers, and ultimately negotiate to pay less over time. So the moment you pay less for your supplies, you're able to save money for the company, the money that's going out, and build on your cash flow to be able to have a healthy cash flow. Then when you're operating a bank account, look out for accounts that offer high interest on your account. So here you're able to build some money, for example, the money that's coming from the interest. If you're operating a dollar account, you should be able to earn some earnings from the what we call the dollar exchange rate gains, and all this money can help you to beef up a very healthy cash flow. And lastly, small business owners, always forecast your cash flow. Plan for your cash flow. When you plan for a cash flow, you will not be into trouble as to when you may probably need money, when you probably need it at an opportune time. When you plan when you'll be having money, and when you plan when you'll be spending the money, the business will move very smoothly. I thank you.
So personal finance, whether it is your personal business or it is your finances, we're talking about financial management, it's just important that you have some discipline about how you spend your money. At the end of the day, if all you do is spending without taking account of where you're putting the money, you might want to think twice because it will somehow get back to you. Let's talk Forex and money markets report. The shilling has been relatively stable through the week. Here's now the comprehensive report of the Forex and money market. So before I go, you clearly know that now what? We are heading into March, already the third month of the year. So if you're sitting back and looking at your January goals that you set, I keep saying, just keep ticking what has worked. And what is still hanging will definitely come through if you keep focused on your goals. I also know for a fact that for those of you that are shipping, yes, marine cargo insurance is coming through. So there's a conversation about how this should work. A meeting with the traders and the different importers is supposed to happen, and it should help align things because there was a bit of a backtrack after some issues with the traders saying they didn't quite understand how this works. So we can hope that moving forward, those of you that are bringing goods, you can have them insured locally and have the insurance industry grow. My name is Simon. That's it for this week. Feel free to get in touch with us. And for those of you that want more on the updates, watch the Rush Hour every weekdays, Mondays to Thursdays at 7:15 to 7:30 for the latest in the world of business. From me and the rest of the team, we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.